Welcome to today's network seminar. Today our speaker is a PhD student at RBC-CPS, Akshata Jagadish. She works with Professor Manoj Verma of SENS. She'll be talking about micro robotic systems. So Akshata.
Hello everyone. Thank you for the introduction, Krishna. So the title of the talk is Design and Control of Micro Robotic Systems. So what is a micro-robotic system? It is a system of controllable machines at micro scale, which finds a very good application in the field of medicine. So why do we need such a system? Let us look at some reasons. There are limitations in the conventional drug treatment, especially cancer treatment. And a system for targeted delivery of drug, on the other hand, overcome these limitations by minimizing side effects, reducing drug intake frequency, improving in vivo drug stability, concentrating drug on a target area, and also reducing the risk of adverse drug reactions, to name a few. The current advancement in nanotechnology further encourages tangible research at micro scale. Micro-robotic system could also find applications in environmental monitoring, water body treatment, small-scale manufacturing, and so on. Now that we see the research area we're pursuing, let us first understand the nature of physics at micro-scale. So this clip here shows a very important characteristic of micro-scale environment. So the experimenter here drops a few blobs of color in silicon, which emulate micro-scale characteristics at macro, and stirs the mixture and retraces his movement. We can observe that the blobs have regained their original shape. So this characteristic is captured by a physical quantity called the Reynolds number. This value reduces as the size of robot decreases. Shows the Reynolds number values for different organisms for the company. What we can understand here is that...
Akshata? Yeah, I think your voice is breaking up a bit. Perhaps you can check your connection or maybe speak a little slowly so that people can follow, because your voice is breaking because of the network or something.
Okay, I will go a bit slowly. Should I repeat anything? The
previous slide where you spoke about the Reynolds number, it was not very clear. You can repeat it if you...
Okay. So this characteristic of the phenomenon that we saw in this video is captured by a physical quantity called the Reynolds number, which is the ratio of viscous forces to inertial forces. This value reduces as the size of the robot or organism decreases. The table that is presented here shows the Reynolds number values for different organisms for comparison. What we can observe here is that the type of actuator changes at micro to structures like cilia, those kind of things, which have more than 1 degree of freedom. Unlike rotation, we need such high degree of freedom movements to induce successful motion at micro scale. Here we can look at some examples of implementation from literature. This is a rigid flagella-shaped microbot controlled with a Helmholtz coil. A sperm-shaped microbot, a paramecium-inspired microbot which has cilia, chemically powered Janus particles, bacteria that are enhanced with magnetic particles and controlled with a similar coil as shown here. And some other with different types of flagella. So all these micro robots can be classified into these four categories. based on the method of actuation. So there are actuation methods such as a magnetic field induced motion, sound induced motion, microorganisms are used for actuation, for actuation of passive particles, and there are also chemical reaction based methods of actuation. I should also mention here that there are also light induced actuation, but the induction of light is used to initiate a chemical reaction. So they come under chemical reaction based actuation. Okay. Now that we saw of different kinds of micro robots, major observation here is that they cannot do alone by themselves. So we need them. Them to be in a large number, and for in such a situation, a swarm intelligence comes into picture. So, what are the characteristics of this kind of a system? So, these are some of the characteristics. For example, emergence. So, local simple interactions by the microbes or organisms, you can consider whichever you want to. They give rise to something new and complex on the, you know, whole, if you look at them together. And they're also robust, meaning if there is a fault or one of the robots misbehaves or dies, the swarm can still work. So they are robust to failure. They are flexible, meaning any change in the perception, it is very easily transmitted to the rest of the robots. And as a result, we see that this kind of a swarm system is superior to a single complex robot. Now that we have, so this was an introduction to this system. So let's look at the goal of what we are trying to design. So this small animation here depicts the goal of a swarm system. So this red square or rectangular region here, assume that this is the affected tissue. And these are the swarm of micro robots. And what do we want them to do? We want them to, you know, stay together, move, reach the affected tissue and deliver the drugs or do whatever that are required of them. So the goal is for the drug carrying micro robots to reach the affected tissue with application specific optimality requirements. So what are these optimality requirements? They depend on the application. For example, sometimes we need the bots to reach the tissue very fast. So that would be one of the constraints. Or we would need a large number of bots to reach the tissue, irrelevant of the time taken. So there are different types of constraints that would come up. So in the further slides, we'll see in detail how we try to achieve a system that does this. So before that, let's look at how we can control these robots. So there are two types of control. One is autonomous control and the other is global control. Let us look at the difference between the two and also understand them in detail. So in autonomous control, the bots are complex. They have their own sensors, actuators, and decision-making capabilities. And therefore, each bot that we have in a swarm is complex. In global control, the bots may be simple because they have an external decision maker and the external control can also control them. In autonomous control, as we saw earlier, there is a swarm intelligence that is emerging from local interaction. In global control, it is not like that because all the patterns and movements are predetermined and are executed by the external controller. Another difference would be these autonomous bots must be internally powered. for them to be working. And in global control, the external controller that we can have can also power them from outside. Also note that these are not very strict differences. There could also be some hybrid systems which take into factors from both of these types. For example, autonomous bots that are powered globally, something like that. So these points here are just given to get a feel of the two systems. So we have taken two approaches to come up with the strategy. So one is the control strategy, where it's more of a software simulation, and we come up with some control techniques to develop the system. And the other is hardware emulation, basically depicts what we try to do in the software simulation. So let us look at control strategy first. So the solution for the development of micro robotic system will possibly evolve as shown in this slide here. First would be the baseline of zero control, where swarm without the application of control have their own behavior. We try to analyze and model this, where over which the different techniques can be applied. So that would be the baseline of zero control. Next would be the mean control, where the mean position of the swarm is tried to vary with the help of external control to move the entire swarm towards the target. Next be the variance control, where there is a control signal applied to keep the diffusing swarm together. We see that the swarm is increasing in its area of occupancy, so we need a control signal to keep it together. Note that this kind of control has to dynamically change the magnitude for a particle depending on its position in the swarm. So it can't be a constant force throughout the swarm. It has to vary depending on the position. Next is an autonomous swarm that has bots making their own decisions with little help from external control. This is basically the vision of the development of our of a micro robotic system. So let us start off with the baseline of zero control. So for that, let us see how the swarm moves. So this is similar to the, you know, you have seen ink particles diffusing in the water. So it is somewhat like that. So that is characteristically measured by something called the diffusion constant, which indicates the rate at which the swarm spreads out. So we can see that the overall radius of the swarm increases with time. So this is how we model the swarm system, where it's Gaussian distributed. So we are looking at a 2D environment. So Gaussian distributed, this means zero, that is just for simplicity, that you can assume as the initial point where the swarm starts. And the variance of the swarm is at the rate 2dt. T is time over here, and dx and dy indicate the diffusion constant in two different directions, x and y, if they are different. Now that we have modeled the swarm system, let's see how to calculate how many bots or particles are reaching the target region. So let us look at the system parameters before we go there. So the target is defined, assumed to be rectangular with a size A, and it is at a distance L from the initial point of the swarm, and it's at an angle theta. Since it's a 2D environment, this is sufficient to look at the environment. So how do we calculate the number of bots reaching the target? Since it was a Gaussian distributed system. It is simply the integration of the probability distribution. So that is depicted here. And once we calculate this, we come up with this expression. So FB here indicates fraction of bots reaching the target at time t. So to simplify this further, let's assume the diffusion constant in both directions, x and y, are same, which is equal to d. So that is captured with the subscript ISO. So we assume the swarm is isotropic. So this is the expression for an isotropic swarm. And the number of fraction of bots in an isotropic swarm at time t is given by this expression. Now, before going further, I want to tell you about two types of targets that we can think of. One is the non-absorbing target, where it's just a passive region and it doesn't change the distribution of the bots. So the bots reach or move over, and we just see how many of the bots reach the target. But you can see the video on the right, which is the absorbing target, where the bots reaching the target are swallowed by the target. So once that is being done, the target is not passive anymore. And the distribution of the particles cannot be Gaussian over all time now. So how do we calculate the number of bots reaching the target for an absorbing target? For a non-absorbing target, what we captured here is sufficient. This is the expression. For an absorbing target, this is how we plan to do. One point to note here that once the bot reach the boundary of the target, they are swallowed in. So they are not allowed to go to the center of the target. So what we do is zoom in on the target and just look at the boundary, that is the gray region. So the size of this is named ASA. And note that it has to be less than a constant. Otherwise, again, the distribution change effects come into picture. So A sub square by D should be less than a constant. And what we do here is, at each time, we calculate the number of bots reaching the boundary. That is just the summation of bots reaching each of these spaces here. So that is given by this expression. And over all time, what we get is, this is something like a Fibonacci series with a small correction factor. So this was the number of bots captured in the last step, and this is in the current step. So this 1 minus eta of n minus 1 is just given to take into account the decreasing number of bots affecting the probability distribution. So this is the expression for capture efficiency. So capture efficiency is nothing but the fraction of bots reaching an absorbing target. So from now on, we'll use this terminology, capture efficiency. So let us look at some simulation that verifies that expression that we got. So the blue line here indicates the simulated capture efficiency, where the bots are left to diffuse and the number of absorbed bots are noted and accumulated. The red line indicates the expression that we got in the previous slide. So these are the parameters for this simulation example. So we can know that the curve reaches a steady state. It's not exactly a steady state value, but reaches a point after which there is barely any increase. So let's call that max value as eta max. Let us take another example just to compare the eta max value for two different simulations. So the only difference between the two is the target size is different. We can note that if the target size is higher, the capture efficiency would be higher. the target size is small, the capture efficiency is small. Specifically, the maximum capture efficiency. Now, till now, we have not applied any control to this form, and we have been looking at the worst case scenario of the capture efficiency. Now, let's see what happens when we apply control. So the simplest way to control this form would be to apply a constant velocity to all the bots in the form in the direction of the target, because we already know its position and orientation. So what happens when we do that? The swarm starts moving towards the target while spreading out at the same time. The target is absorbing in nature. So from now on, we look at only absorbing target because it's more realistic. So the target is absorbing in nature and the swarm keeps moving. So in control one, we are not stopping the swarm. So it is allowed to move, and you can see in velocity control 2 that we have stopped the application of swarm, and we have allowed, we are making use of the natural behavior of the swarm to diffuse around the target so that the capture efficiency increases. So let us look at the simulation when we do this. So these are the parameters that we have considered, and we have applied this much velocity. So it's quite apparent now, when there is no velocity control, eta max value is 0.16. And when we apply the first type of control, where we do not stop the swarm, but keep applying velocity, eta max value is 0.17. And when we do the second type of control, it's where we stop applying the velocity once the mean position of the swarm reaches the target, we get a better capture efficiency value of 0.19. So this is pretty good. Next, what we did was we tried to increase the value of velocity and see if the capture efficiency increases. Well, it does. We see here that so this is for without velocity, without application of velocity, and we have considered only control 2, velocity control 2, where we stop the application of velocity. So we see that the capture efficiency increases, and it increases and reaches 1. But is this feasible? This kind of velocity is impossible to attain, practically speaking. So, so this implies that mean control alone is not sufficient to obtain very high capture efficiency, and thus we need variance control. So this work has been published in Mass Conference in 2019. And moving on, so this was till now, what we saw was passive particles. So the particles didn't have any behavior of its own. So they were diffusing because of collision and not by their own there was no propulsion on their own. Now let us look at a different kind of system, basically active matter, where the particles are active, and the simulation that we have adopted here mimics a run and tumble motion of bacteria. So what's a run and tumble motion? That is basically when the particles undergo something called the run duration, where it travels with a constant velocity for some time and randomly changes its orientation, which is called the tumble. They follow these equations of motion, where V0 is the constant velocity, and phi is random here, which changes, takes in random values after some time. Note that we can also define a diffusion constant for this system, which is given by V squared by alpha D. V here is the same as V0, the constant velocity that is undergoes during the run, and alpha is the rate at which tumbles occur, and D is the size of the robot. So we simulated these kind of particles, and this is how they move. Note that this is somewhat similar to passive particles, but there are some differences. Now, to model the baseline of zero for this as well, we plotted the probability distribution of these particles over time. We see that it's not a proper Gaussian for like passive particles. So they have some multimodal distribution, and the analysis of this has been done in this paper for 1D. For 2D, it's somewhat hard. But this simulation was for 2D, and we see that the graphs are somewhat similar. In our future work, we'll try to theoretically analyze the distribution of these particles. Okay, moving on. We try to apply the mean control for these active particles. Before we go into that, note that these are somewhat similar to the example that we saw earlier. Bacteria infused with magnetic particles and then controlled with the help of a magnetic field. So the bacteria are active particles, and they are globally controlled with magnetic field. So these are the results that we got. Similar graphs that we saw earlier. So these are capture efficiency plots. Note that this black line here, that is the capture efficiency for a run and tumble model, that is active particles. And these are all the capture efficiency values for passive particles with comparable values of diffusion constant. Major observation here is the run and tumble model have better results than passive particles. So this is very interesting, and it would help the designers, you know, to have some self-propelling systems to use for micro-robotic systems. They would definitely give better results than, you know, just having some passive magnetic particles that are controlled by magnetic field, for an example. Now, let's change direction here and see the hardware emulation that we have tried to adopt to depict the same that we have done in the control strategy. Okay, here we are showing a software speaker setup that is used to emulate passive particles undergoing Brownian motion. So this is the base plate over which the particles are allowed to move, and the random Brownian motion is simulated with the help of speaker setup that is present here. And the mean control is done by changing the angle of the base plate with the help of stepper motor. It leads course that is present here. And there is an overhead camera to capture the images or the video of the entire simulation. So this is the setup that we have done. So the outer box is for soundproofing the system since it's a speaker setup. And this is a video of the motion caused by the speaker. Note that we can also do variance control in the future. We have not designed that yet, but we can place a magnetic field system around to control the particles, and we can make the particles magnetic. And we also plan to do a closed loop feedback control since we have a camera here, and we can control the angle of the base plate to induce mean control. So that is a future plan. So just to summarize what we have done, in the control strategy, we looked at two simulations, passive simulations and passive particle simulation or active particle simulation. And we reached mean control. There were four steps: baseline of zero control, mean control, variance control, and autonomous swarm. We reached mean control. Variance control is still in process. And we also need to theoretically analyze active particle characteristics in 2D with and without control. And for the hardware emulation, so this what we saw here was a dry system. The particles are on a dry surface, and we need to do a variable control setup for the same. And in the future, we also plan to do some emulation with the help of camphor boards. Camphor boards are basically propelled with the help of camphor. So if you place camphor, camphorous particles, say, you might have looked at some examples of camphor placed on a cardboard, and you see the cardboard moving around the water. So we plan to use that and simulate active matter simulations as well. So that's it. I guess I've finished soon. Okay. Can go ahead with questions.
Yeah, thank you, Akshita. So we've finished the talk a little early. So do anyone of you have questions now? So let me ask a question. Okay, Pritam. Pritam, you can go, Pritam.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes.
Okay, so is there an equivalent of waveforming in delivering the energy to these micro robots and also to nudge them or provide them some signals? Like the beam forming that we use in wireless networks. So something equivalent in acoustic systems, can it be used?
Yes, definitely, Pritam. Whatever you're saying here, so if you're looking at the beam forming, it could definitely be used for variance control, because as I said before, the micro robots need different magnitude of control signals depending on the swarm location. So if we can design the beam that we have applied, be it magnetic beam or sound beam or a light beam, depending on whatever system that we can think of, it can definitely be used for the control design of micro robots for variance control.
Okay, thank you.
So Krishna here. So typically, what kind of robots have autonomous control built into them?
There are autonomous robots at a larger scale, not many at nano scale. There are some at millimeter scale. So there are some examples of robots arranging themselves to form some patterns. You must have seen them, like kilobots. They are called kilobots.
I see.
Yeah. So they basically behave like ants. Ants or termites. Is there some difference?
No, nothing.
Okay, so they basically behave like ants or termites in a swarm. So they make decisions based on their surrounding bots and they arrange themselves. Similarly, all the bots do that. So each bot doesn't have the global idea of what is happening. They're just given sensory signals of things surrounding them. They don't have the picture of the entire swarm. But still, the entire swarm works. So those are some of the examples. The best natural examples are ants or swarms or the fish that you saw in the video.
Okay. Thank you.
Hello, Akshita. Can you go back to the slide when you were talking about this, the active sensors or the active robots?
Yeah. My screen is out, right?
Okay? It's on the thank you slide.
Okay. Just a minute. Yeah, which slide? Sorry, could you please?
I mean, you're talking about the active sensors and the RTM thing, right? Towards then.
Oh, okay.
Active matter simulation. Yeah, here you were mentioning that we have this x dot equals v naught cos phi t and v naught sin phi t, right? So, you said that phi is modeled to be random. So, how are you modeling it in your simulation?
In the simulation, we have not theoretically modeled. We have just algorithmically simulated the robot.
Okay.
That is what I said. When in the future work, we'll be theoretically modeling the simulation to get some, you know, mathematical expressions like for the passive particles that we have got, you know, here.
Okay.
You know, something like this. So that is not yet being done. But it has been done for 1D in the paper.
So how do people typically model it in 1D?
So in 1D, 5 is assumed to be root of 2D eta of t, where eta is
efficiency. Okay.
Yeah, something like that. Again, there is eta is stationary distribution. It's a delta correlated simulation. So each time it's dependent. So basically, these are called Langevin equations in physics. So we have used Langevin equations to simulate the whole system and for theoretical analysis in this paper, steady state relaxation and first passage property, they integrated over time to get a probability distribution. That is what they've got this. Those are called Fokker-Planck equations.
Okay.
So want to read more about them.
Got it. Thank you.
Are there any more questions? Okay, if there are none, let's thank Akshita for her talk.
Thank you.
Thank you, Akshita. If you wish to present in the network seminar or you know someone who wants to, they can contact the volunteers, that is me and Arvind Rameshwar. Thank you for attending network seminar.